take you to the book of Acts, chapter 27. It's the book of action. And I'm reading a New King James Version. And we're going to begin to read from verse 19 of 27. Praise God. But in order to put our text into perspective, let me take you back to chapter 26, the previous chapter. That's chapter 26. And I'm just paraphrasing. After being accused and causing trouble, Paul was arrested, all for the sake of preaching the gospel of Jesus Christ. And if we study the life of Paul, we know the man he was. And after his conversion, seeing that before his conversion, he had passion in persecuting the church. And after his conversion, he did not lose that passion, but God turned that passion into preaching the gospel message of Jesus Christ. So as he began to preach the gospel, he was a threat to those around him. And Paul was being brought before Festus and King Agrippa to plead his case. But they found no wrongdoing in the man. So he was sent to Caesar in Rome. And it is at chapter 27 that Paul's voyage to Rome began. His journey to Rome began. As a prisoner, they put him aboard a ship with other prisoners, and they began to sail. But Paul, being a man in the Spirit of God, being a man who knows God, he warned them. And if you go back early up to verse 10 of 27, Paul warned them that the voyage will end with disaster and much loss, and not only of the cargo and ship, but also of lives. Nevertheless, they choose not to listen to him, and they went on to sail. So while sailing, they encounter a storm at sea. And that's where we bring us to verse 19 of 27. And on the third day, we threw the ship's tackle overboard with our own hands. Now, when neither sun nor stars appear for many days, and no small tempest beat on us, all hope that we would be saved was finally given up. But after long abstinence from food, then Paul stood in the midst of them and said, "Men, you should have listened to me and not have sailed from Crete and incurred this disaster and lost." And now I urge you to take heart, for there will be no loss of life among you, but only of the ship. For there stood by me this night an angel of God, to whom I belong and whom I serve, saying, do not be afraid, Paul, for you must be brought before Caesar. And indeed, God has granted you all those who sail with you. Therefore, take heart, men, for I believe God that it will be just as it was told me. However, we must run aground on a certain island. Now, when the 14th night had come, as we were driven up and down in the Aratic Sea, about midnight the sailors sensed that they were dragging near some land, and they took sounding, found it to be 20 fathoms, and when they had gone a little while farther, they took sounding again and found it to be 15 fathoms. Then, fearing lest we should run aground on the rocks, they dropped 4 anchors from the stern and prayed for day to come. And as the sailors were seeking to escape from the ship, when they had let down the skiff into the sea, under pretense of putting out anchors for the prow, Paul said to the centurion and the sailors, unless these men stay in the ship, you cannot be saved. Then the sailors cut away the rope of the skiff and let it fall off. And as day was about to dawn, Paul implored them all to take food, saying, today is the 14th day you have waited and continue without food and eating nothing. Therefore, I urge you to take nourishment, for this is for your survival, since not a hair will fall from the head of any of you. And when he had said these things, he took bread, gave thanks to God in the presence of them all. And when he had broken it, he began to eat. Then they were all encouraged and also took food themselves. And in all, we were 227 prisoner persons on the ship. So when they had eaten enough, they lightened the ship and threw out the wheat into the sea. Heavenly Father, we look to you this morning for your direction. And we ask you, O God, to allow your Holy Spirit to take charge this morning. Father, bring change to those who are going to hear the word. And help us all that we make application to your word this morning. Lord, we thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. This morning I have entitled this message, Facing a Storm Inside of a Storm. Facing a storm inside of a storm. I have sat and I have pondered on the text. And I have realized that life is about challenges. In life, there will be challenge that every one of us will be faced with. And many times, we refer to those challenges as storms that come ahead of us. Every one of us will face difficulties or storms in our lives. But the question is, how are we going to face these storms, these challenges, these obstacles? How are we going to face them when they come our way? This morning, based on the text that we read, I have three lessons I want to share with us. Three lessons that we can learn from, that Paul has taught us in the text as to how to survive, or how to face these storms when they come our way. Lesson number one, we must realize when we're facing a storm inside of a storm, we must realize that there are some storms that are unavoidable. Lesson number two. When we're facing a storm inside of a storm, we will see that Paul was an encourager. So he was an encourager. And lesson number three, he had the favor of God with him. He had the favor of God with him. So lesson number one, there are some storms that are unavoidable. And if you go to verse 21 of chapter 27, it said, but after long abstinence from food, then Paul stood in the midst of them and said, men, you should have listened to me and not have seen. Paul had warned them that there will be troubles, folks, but they choose to ignore his warning as they put their trust in other things. They trusted in the helmsman and the captain, and maybe because they thought that these men are full of experience, they are accustomed sailing the ocean, but they ignore the warning from Paul. So here we see that here is a storm that could have been avoided. These issues that they face could have been avoided if only they have listened to Paul, friends. And if they have listened to Paul, they would not have encountered these problems. It could have been avoided. Because Paul knew his God. And he was sensitive to the Spirit of God. And so he warned them that they will be troubled. But they choose not to take heed of the warning. So instead, they ignore Paul's warning. And they listen to other voices. Friends, as believers, we must be careful sometimes as to who we listen to. We must be careful. We must be careful as to who we listen to in life. Because as we see in the text, it could result in us making wrong choices all depends on the people that we listen to. And many times the wrong choices and we end up in trouble. But the text does not stop there. It goes on to verse 22. And it said, "And now I urge you to take heart, for there will be no loss of life among you, but only of the ship." So even though they did not listen, Paul still let them know that despite they did not listen, despite of that they will encounter troubles and difficulties, there will be no loss of life. But they will be lost of the ship and cargo. So there is still some consequences for the action. But he said in verse 23, "For there stood by me this night an angel of the God of whom I belong and whom I serve, saying, do not be afraid, Paul. You must be brought before Caesar." And here we see, hence the reason why I said that there are some storms in life that are unavoidable. Because here is the angel encouraging Paul, saying to him, despite of what you're going to go through, you must be brought before Caesar. You cannot escape the plan that is before you. You maybe could have escaped some of the obstacles, but you cannot escape, for you must be brought before Caesar. So here we see Paul. Paul could not have escaped his journey to Rome, even if he wanted to. Paul was in chain as a prisoner, bound for Rome, not knowing what he will face. Yet before he arrived, he encountered lots of challenges along the way. And Paul did not ask God, "Why me?" He did not complain about his situation, friends. And many times we encounter problems in life. Many times we go through struggles. The quickest thing for us to do is to ask God a question. "Lord, why me?" Friends, I have learned that we cannot question God. We could ask God some question, like, "Lord, what is the lesson in this for me?" But we cannot question God, saying, "Why me?" We don't know what God has in store for us. And sometimes we go through challenging life. And there is a saying that challenges will make you stronger, friends. And when you go through challenge, it either makes you or it breaks you. And as believers, we have to encourage ourselves Knowing the God we serve, we must stand firm despite the challenge, despite the storm. You don't know the end results. Maybe God wants to build some character in us. Maybe he's preparing us for something bigger and better ahead. We don't know. But we sometimes question God. And here we see Paul. Paul did not question God. Here is a man, a prisoner, bound for Rome. He don't know what is going to become of his life. But he continued to keep courage. He did not question God. My question to us this morning, how are you facing your storms in life today? Are you asking God, why me? Are you complaining about every bad situation life throws at you? Think for a minute. Many of us are facing storms in life. And not just us. The world is experiencing a big storm right now with COVID. Many have lost their job. Friends, after facing that virus, still losing your job, and still there are little storms that are going to arise among you that you have to face still in life, even though we are facing that big storm, friends. But I'm here to encourage us this morning. I'm here to encourage us to don't give up and don't lose sight of God and continue to trust God, friends, because he knows the outcome of the situation. Paul was in a state that was unavoidable. He could not escape because the angels tell him, you must go before Caesar. He must go. What is the Spirit saying to you this morning in your time of storm? Instead of asking God, God, why me? Ask God, God, what is the lesson am I supposed to learn in this time as I go through my storm in life? Hallelujah. The second point, he was an encourager. He was an encourager. Verse 25 said, therefore, take heart, for I believe God that it will be just as it was told. Paul encouraged the men. Even though he himself was in trouble, he encouraged the crew. He encouraged the fellow prisoners aboard the ship, saying to them, take heart. If you listen to last Sunday's message, it talks about being an encourager, friends. And if you have missed that message, let me say you missed a good thing. And it shows us, it talks about Paul and how he was an encourager. And we know that in the text, he stood and he said, "Take heart, men. All is not lost." I don't know about you, but sometimes your own storm in life is so heavy. You know, I don't know if you understand what I'm saying, but sometimes you are facing such heavy storm in your own life, and then somebody comes to you and trying to tell you about their situation in life. And you're probably thinking, well, I have my own struggles in life. How can I encourage somebody when I myself is going through such a hard time? But we see Paul's life as an example. He stood as an example in the midst of everyone. And he said to them, even though he was a prisoner himself, he stood and he said, "Take heart, friends. For I believe that God will be just as it was told." When you're going through your struggles in life, can you still stand and tell somebody, "Don't worry"? Sometimes the problem that you're facing, it overwhelms you so much. It's difficult. And yet, you have to be an encourager to somebody who is going through their situation. Friends, in this time, in these days, if our focus is not on the Almighty God, if we do not see Christ as the rock in whom we stand, many a times we will become discouraged. Many times. And many times we will say, what you come down and complain to me for? I am my own struggles facing, you know? But as believers, God wants us to see him as the rock and the provider. And he wants us to place our anchor on him. He wants us to be an encourager to somebody else, even though you are facing your struggles in life. He wants us to know him. Friends, be an encourager to somebody. And last week's message tells us everything about how to be an encourager and why we should be an encourager to somebody in our lives. Even though we are faced with struggles and problems and situations, friends, Paul said, "Take heart." But in verse 26, it goes on to say, "However, we must run aground on a certain island." And I love Paul's expressions there. You know, Paul was straight to the point. Even though he was encouraging friends, the men, the people, the crew. You know, sometimes we encourage people in things and we like to tell them the good things. And sometimes we know that there are things that they're going to face But we refuse to tell them because we are afraid. Because they may see it as bad things that will happen. But we see it as an example. Paul stood. He was honest. An honest man. And he lay it as it is. He said, though you are facing challenges in life, though none of the life aboard the ship will be lost, but let me tell you something, friends. We must run aground on a certain island. So in his time of encouragement, he was saying, yes, you are going through your storm. Yes, you are facing difficulties. But let me tell you something. As you sail, all sailing will not be smooth. In your Christian walk, friends, will not be a sweet bag of roses. Yes, you will encounter problems in your life. The struggles is real. There are some that you will not be able to escape. It's right before us. We will go through it. But even as you journey through them, friends, let me tell you this morning, there are bumps that you're going to encounter. There are roadblocks that is going to come your way. There are difficulties that are going to show up along as your journey. But I'm here to let you know this morning, don't give up. You continue to know and understand the God in whom you serve. Because as you journey, he's there with you. And his word said that he will never leave us, nor forsake us, but be with us till the very end. The storm is real, but my God is bigger than the storm. My God is bigger than every circumstances that you face. And if we stand on the word of God, we could become an encourager to ourselves and to others, knowing that the struggles is real. My encouragement to us this morning is to be an encourager. Be an encourager to somebody this morning. Be an encourager. In verse 34 of 27, Paul goes on to say, therefore, I urge you to take nourishment, for this is your survival. Since not a hair will fall from the head of any of you. Isn't that great encouragement, friends? Isn't that great encouragement? Friends, you may not understand. You may not be able to picture it. But as a fisherman, I know from whence I speak. Listen, when you're out at the ocean and when you look up, it's only skies and clouds. And you look on every side, all you see is water. And especially when the weather is make up, friends. If you don't have any sense of direction, if you don't have the courage and know where you're going, it will frighten you, friends. It will frighten you. But somebody stepped out. Despite of all that, they probably think that everything is lost. Paul steps out and encourage them. saying that all is not lost. Take heart, my friends. Be an encourager to somebody this morning. And don't be afraid if you're encouraging somebody into making certain decisions. Don't tell them that everything is going to be all right. Encouraging them. Encourage them. Let them know. Let them know that sometimes there are times when, you know, you might face a little difficult situation. A little road bump will come up in the road. But still, continue to do what you're doing and keep your eyes on Jesus. The storm arose, and it was not all smooth sailing. There was challenges. There was challenges. Paul, late as it is. Point number three. He had the favor of God with him. In verse 35. And when he had said these things, he took bread and gave thanks to God in the presence of them all. And when he had broken it, he began to eat. From the moment of Paul's conversion, the favor of God was with him. And if you study the life of Paul, you'll see that Paul had a great anointing on his life. You'll see that Paul was an apostle that was taught by Jesus, by the Holy Spirit himself. So he had that favor of God even to the end of his life. Paul remained faithful to God. When he was brought before kings, they could not find any wrongdoing in the man because he had the favor of God upon his life. In the same text, chapter 27, verse 3, we see Julius. It said that Julius treated him kindly and gave him liberty to move around the ship. And remember that Paul was a prisoner on that ship. Yet he treated him kindly. And friend, this is because of the favor of God upon Paul's life. When you have the favor of God with you, no matter what man do, they will not be able to stop you. When the ship was in trouble and everyone has lost hope, Paul, who was a prisoner, took control. Can you imagine that? He's a prisoner aboard that ship. And yet, he had to stand and take control of the entire ship and crew because he had the favor of God with him. When we got the favor of God in our lives, things will happen. And many a times we will not be able to explain, except to just thank God for his favor in our lives. Don't try to explain it, but just thank God for his favor in our lives. And as we have read the text, it said that Paul took bread. And in the presence of everyone, he gave thanks to God, friends. In the presence of the captain and crew, in the presence of the rest of the prisoners, Paul demonstrates a life of living in Christ Jesus. His life, he showed us as an example. In other words, Paul was saying, it's not about me. It's not about I, Paul. I had nothing to do with our survival. It's not about me. But it's about the one in whom I trust and in whom I serve. And he demonstrates that as an example to the rest of the crew. And he showed them. And the text said that he gave thanks to God for what he has done. Friends, it's important to give thanks to God. It's important that we don't try to take things that belongs to God upon ourselves. I have heard men who have done things who are so boastful in themselves say, boy, I good. You see what? I could handle that, you know. And some of them escape. They take it because of my driving skills. No. It is because of the grace and the mercy of God that we exist today, friends. And Paul stood in the midst of them and he said, this is who has allowed us to be here today. Take note. Don't be afraid. When God has done something in your life, don't be afraid to thank him for it. Be thankful to God. For I know the God in whom I serve and whom I belong. It is because of his grace and his mercies that we are all alive today. That is what Paul was saying in essence. It's not me. God has favored me to encourage you. But we must give him thanks because of what he has done. Thank God for his favor in your life today. Many of us are here. We must thank God for his favor. We are alive. We are well. And even though we have little thing in our body, you know, we hand might be hurting, we feet might, but thank God we are alive and well. And when we are in the land of the living this morning, friends, and it's only because of his mercies, only because of his grace, his unmerited favor towards us, his love, that is what's going to keep us. Be thankful to God, friends. In conclusion, let me ask you these questions. Are you facing some storms in your life today? If you're facing, how are you doing? Do you need the favor of God in your life to help you? And if you need the favor of God, you must seek God and ask him. He's right there. right there with you right now. You can ask him for his favor. He's there with you. Let me share a little something that I have learned from watching the National Geographic Channel. And I have learned something about the cattle of the desert. There are some cattle when storms come in, what they do is that if the storm is coming, there are these cattle that run ahead of the storm. So when the storm comes, many of them are not fast enough, you know? So they try to run away from the storm. But the storm comes and many of them get trapped. And it results in lots of loss of lives and lots of them being injured and so on. But as I listen further on, they say, there is this particular cattle called the buffalo. And they are so unique. And whenever a storm arises in the desert, what happens to them is that they don't do as the other cattle run away. They stand. And if the storm is coming, they face the storm. And they head into the storm. And what happened, they say, that after the storm has passed, they show behind it, the buffaloes are grazing and enjoying themselves. And they say what happened, they realize that there are less casualties because the way they approach their situation. They did not try to run away from it. But what they do, they run into the storm. And when they run into the storm, they come out victorious on the other end. I'm saying this morning to us, that we must live as the buffalo. We must face our storm in life. Because at the end, there is a rainbow, friends. At the end, you will come out victorious. The word of God says, some through the water, some through the flood. But every one of us, he'll carry us through the precious blood. This morning, I hope that this message will encourage you this morning. I hope that you'll be able to face your storm, knowing that God is with you. Don't try to run away from it because it will catch up with you. But do as the buffalo and face it, knowing that God is with you. I'm trusting that you are encouraged this morning. Let us all stand to our feet. Hallelujah.
Praise God. Promise still stands. promise still stands. Great is your faithfulness.